morning and welcome to First United Methodist Church. My name is Amy Schumacher. I'm the leader of the praise team. Would you please stand with us and we'll sing our first song, You Never Let Go.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I
me he would take care of my mic. Okay, fail number one for this service. That's good. All right, great. Glad to have you here as we gather to worship and to praise God and to open our hearts to hear what it is that God has to say to us today. Let us continue our worship and praise.
Amen.
my strength. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength.
Repeat after me.
as we gather this morning as children of God, of our Lord and Savior and our King. We want to center our hearts in a time of silence that we may prepare for offering our prayers before God this morning. Let us continue to open our hearts and to be in an attitude of prayer as we sing.
My soul be still and do not fear. The winds of change may rage tomorrow. God is at your side. No longer dread the fires of unexpected sorrow.
God, we do come to rest in you alone, to open ourselves to your call on our lives, to grow more like Christ in all that we do. But as your children, as your people, you do call us to pray, to lift up our prayers for you so that we are connected to one another and connected to every person and every place throughout the world through our prayers. And so, God, today we lift up our prayers for those who we know who are hurting, whether it be from tragedy in their lives and the grief that they are suffering, whether it be from abuse and violence that they have encountered and endured, whether it just be because they are lost. We lift up our prayers for those who are hurting. And Holy God, we lift up prayers for those who are in need of your healing, the physical healing that comes from illness that we so desire for those we love and for ourselves, for release from things that bind us, that we can't shake, from those addictions that hold us hostage, but also for healing of our souls and our emotions, so that we may be freed to be more freely who you've called us to be. We also want to remember all of those many places around our world that are suffering, where there has been violence, where there have been natural disasters, where there's been shootings, where there's been hurricanes and typhoons and so many things that cause people to lose their firm footing. May you help to provide that solid foundation in their lives. And may you open us to always be aware of how you are calling us to be your hands and feet in this world. We celebrate the goodness that you have given us. We celebrate the coming of spring and the green grass and the trees that are budding and the flowers that are starting to bloom. We celebrate that you have given such awesome beauty to us. We celebrate our family and our friends who give such joy to us. And all that we are and all that we have is due to you. And so we raise our voices together as one as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Rosanna Selly, and I will be reading the scripture this morning. I'd like to invite you to follow along in your Bible, whether it be on your smart device or in the Bible in the pew located in front of you, and as we share the Word of God. The first scripture is going to be from Galatians 2:15-20. We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners, yet we know that a person is justified not by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus so that we might be justified by faith in Christ, not by doing the works of the law, because no one will be justified by the works of the law. But if in our effort to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have been found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again the very things that I once tore down, then I demonstrate that I am a transgressor. For through the law I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. And then we're going to turn to Matthew 22:36-40. Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest? He said to me, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Thank you, Roseanne. Before I forget, I want to remind you to complete the connection card that is on the bulletin that you were handed, and you will bring that forward with your offering as you come forward to receive communion later on in the service. Also want to remind you that the Palm Sunday schedule is different. So next week is Palm Sunday, and so make sure that you're aware of the change in worship time, and come early enough to have pancake together and to fellowship. I'm Reverend Nancy Lambert, and I'm a United Methodist clergy person currently not serving in a local church. And my husband and I moved to Topeka almost exactly a year ago and have made First United Methodist our home here in Topeka. I work at our conference office and am a Nebraskan. I'm sorry, I'm not a Kansan yet. I'm still a Nebraskan. And I worked out of our office in Lincoln, Nebraska, and the decision a couple years ago was to consolidate to one location, and Topeka was the winner of that prize, and so it caused me to move to Topeka. So I'm glad to be here this morning to offer a word to you in the absence of Jeff. But as a Nebraskan, it has come to my awareness that in the weekly updates from the church that have come out by email and in our bulletin, we have neglected to be connected to our entire conference. As I said, I'm a Nebraskan. Crap has happened in Nebraska, right? 80 of the 93 counties in Nebraska have been declared disasters because of flooding. The 24 inches of snow that the panhandle has accumulated in the March is starting to melt, and the ground's not thawed yet. It's still frozen, and so as that snow melts, it's moving eastward, and so it's raising rivers again, has the potential to renew some flooding where waters had receded. There are cattle that are stranded, surrounded by water, and so hay is being airlifted to those cattle. There are towns that are still not accessible for people to go into and help, and because of the high water and because they haven't deemed safe yet. The farmers have had all of that silt from the bottom of the rivers has been deposited on their fields, and some of it is been rated as toxic, so they cannot even plant their fields this spring, even if it dries up. So the disaster cost to the state of Nebraska is in the billions of dollars. As a United Methodist Conference and as a connectional system, we care for one another, especially those places in our conference where there have been, where they've suffered tragedy and trauma. We have a place on our conference website where you can go and find out how we are helping out for the disaster relief. We have Holly Tapley, who's our disaster relief coordinator, who is probably going to be spending the most of the next 6 to 9 months, if not a full year, up in Nebraska, helping with the disaster relief. We have one of the best processes and systems for disaster relief in our conference. That is something that we celebrate at this point in time. But on the website, you can find out how to contribute to our disaster relief fund. All the money that comes in from that is going to be used in Nebraska to help people who have lost everything. And farmers have lost the grain that they were storing to sell this spring. That's all damaged. Grain bins burst because the seed inside them swelled. And so the disaster is just huge. Our conference website will also show you when and where teams are needed to come in and help. If you're a person who has had some training in early response, we'd love to have you go and help out on those training opportunities, or look at the trainings that we have coming up in the next 2 or 3 months and get yourself trained to be an ERT person so that you can go in and respond. So I hope you will pay attention to that and look at how and think and pray about how you can help those in our conference who have been so drastically affected by the floods. So today is the last Sunday in the series that Jeff has been doing on emotionally healthy spirituality, using Peter Scazzaro's book by that name. And so over the last few weeks, you know, he's been this whole series is about how is it that we live out more intently that great commandment to love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and all our strength, and love our neighbors as ourselves. How do we do that? How do we live as Christians? And so we've talked about how it is that we remember that we are a beloved child of God, And our family and what has happened to us does not define us and does not determine our worth, but it is rather the fact that God loves us regardless, unconditionally. That's what determines our worth and our value. And so Jeff spent some time talking about the false narratives that our culture creates for us, the measures of success that really aren't what need to define us, because it's not about who we are. It's not about what we have. It's not about what we do, and it's not about what other people think about us. It's about Christ living in us. And he's talked about things such as centering prayer and breath prayer as ways to shut out the busyness of our world and focus ourselves for a period of time on what God might be having to say to us. He's talked about following practice of Sabbath, creating intentional time on a weekly basis where you set aside anything that's work and you just take delight in being who you are, being who God has created you to be, being with others who bring joy into your life. And last week, then, he talked about the practice of daily offices, having set rhythms throughout the day where you follow a time of silence, a time of reading scripture, a time of prayer, where you just open yourselves up to this rhythm, this ancient practice of following a rhythm of life. So today is the invitation to think about, how do you make your Christian commitment, how do you make Christ living in you a reality every day of the week? Not just Sunday mornings in worship, but what about the other 6 days of a week? How do you live out your faith in Christ, and how do you make that real so that you are growing more like Christ in all that happens? And so what we're focusing on today is what's called a rule of life. Now, the rule of life is just like all of those other practices that Jeff has talked about. It's an ancient practice. It is modeled for centuries ago by what we call the desert fathers and the desert mothers. Back in the 3rd to 5th centuries, the people who were devoted to living a life of Christianity, of living out their Christian faith, decided that the world around them was causing too much distractions and keeping them from being devoted to God. And so they moved out to the desert and lived kind of in isolation, away from society. There's all kinds of weird stories about, strange stories about what they did. I mean, one guy lived on top of a pole, go figure. But, you know, how they lived their Christian life separate from the world so that they could be totally devoted to God. And over time, some of these became communities. And so the communities developed a rule of life for the community, which the most famous of is the rule of Saint Benedict. And that is still a practice and a way of living in community that is still followed at many monasteries throughout the world today, practiced by Catholics and Protestants alike. So the rule of life is an ancient practice, but it still has validity for today because it helps us to focus our whole life so that nothing is more important than loving God. Now, I don't know about you, but a rule sounds kind of restrictive. I mean, we all remember the rules that our parents set for us, or even those that we set for our kids as they were growing up. Things like bedtime at 8 o'clock. You have to hang your coat up. You can't just drop it on the floor when you come in the room. You got to turn off your lights when you leave a room. You can't leave lights on. You've got to clean up your room on Saturday morning before you can go play. And then the beloved one when you're a teenager with curfew, got to be home at midnight. And there were always consequences if you broke those rules. You lost privileges, like maybe you couldn't have your sleepover with your friends, or you lost TV time, now kids lose screen time. Or maybe you had to go sit in your room and have a timeout, or sit in the corner. Or the dreaded getting grounded when you're a teenager, right? Yeah, so rules have a restrictive side to them that sometimes we rebel against when we hear about creating a rule of life. But really, rules are freeing. Because when there are rules, it gives boundaries and shape to what is acceptable, to what we can do, to where we can go, and to how we live. And so they actually give us freedom, because if you have established rules for how you're going to think, how you're going to act, how you're going to treat other people, then every time you encounter a new situation, you don't have to spend time thinking about what you're going to do. You're going to know. It's going to be automatic because you've created it as part of the way that you live. Now, Scazzaro, in his book, mentions that the word that we use for rule is actually comes from a Greek word meaning trellis. So, you know, if you think about a vine growing up a trellis, I like that image of creating a trellis for our life. Because for me, when I think about trellis, I remember a house that we drove by all the time when I was growing up. I lived in a small town called Battle Creek, Nebraska, up in the northeast part of Nebraska. And we had to drive to Norfolk often, you know, to do the major shopping. It was the big city that was close to us. And driving from Battle Creek to Norfolk on the highway, there was a house that was white brick. And up the front of that house, every spring, summer, was this trellis full of beautiful purple clematis blooming. I loved seeing that house every time when it was in full bloom. Because as I think about that now, that and what a rule being a trellis, for me, what the rule of life does is talks about how is it that we bloom Christ in abundance out of us to all that we encounter. How do you bloom Christ? A trellis provides support for something from the time that it begins to grow. And it provides support and direction for it to grow as it continues to mature and grow up and up and up. So it provides the support that is needed in order for it to become the beautiful thing that God has created it to be. So maybe a rule of life is what helps us to become the beautiful, unique person that God has created us. The Galatians passage that was read, to me, really states what a rule of life is about. And I want to reread just part of that for you. Paul says in here, I died to the law through the law. Now he's talking about the Jewish law that Jesus and the disciples all would have followed as Jewish people. But the law actually almost put people in a box instead of giving them freedom to grow. Because it created so many rules for them for their entire day that it in some ways was restrictive because it took care of some of the minutiae of life. And so it didn't allow freedom to be who God was creating them to be. And so what he's saying is, he says, I died to the law. So in other words, the law no longer was the way to get right with God, so that I could live for God. And I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in my body, I live by faith, indeed by the faithfulness of God's Son, who loved me and gave himself for me. I have been crucified with Christ. Therefore, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. I mean, that's a basic statement of faith of what it means to proclaim Christ as our Savior. That we've been transformed and Christ lives in us. We have been changed by that. And so the rule of life is a way for us to take that faith out of Sunday morning worship and take it into every other moment of our lives. How do we live so that we reflect what Christ would want us to be and who Christ would want us to live? So what is it that guides us other than the world's standards for success? And it can be a rule of life. A rule of life is a choice that you make because it's a way for living, a way to have abundant life. And for me, I think it would be better if it was a rule for life. I like changing that word from of to for, because I believe this rule of life can be life-giving. It shapes your entire life, shapes my life, but it also helps put me in the place where I receive the abundant life that God gives me. So in your bulletins today, you have an insert that is a way to for you to start thinking about, what is my rule of life going to be? Because there is a lot of different pieces that can be in your rule. A rule of life is intended to be a living document, which means you don't just write it once, like in April of 2019, and then never look at it again and never revise it. But a rule of life is intended to be looked at and reviewed regularly to think about, what else do I need to add to this? Or what else do I need to do and challenge myself to grow more into who Christ has called me to be? So some ways to get started is to begin with, what do you already do? Now, I set this up with using the words from your website and the words that you hear about connect, grow, and serve. So what are you already doing to connect with other people? What are you already doing to grow in your faith? What are you already doing to serve Christ, to serve in mission? And what are you doing to rest? So you can start with what you're already doing. But if that's what you're already doing, that is not necessarily challenging you to grow deeper in your relationship with God. So what are the next things that you could do? And as you start developing a rule, you might only choose one or two of these areas to add something new to, so that you have time to practice those so that they become ingrained into who you are. So the one side of this insert is blank, so that you can fill in the boxes yourself and add things that fit you and fit who God has called you to be. But on the other side, then, there are some categories in each of those boxes, some things that you might think about adding into your rule of life. And I want to just explain a few of those, because you might be wondering why they're where they are and what I mean by them. So under connect, we've put emotional health. Why on earth is that a thing to connect? Well, it's to connect with yourself. Getting in touch with who you are. Do you have some unresolved grief or anger in your life that you need to work through and process through? Maybe under connect, you're going to care about your emotional health in such a way that you're going to journal about your emotions. You're going to write letters to God about how you're feeling about this situation that happened years ago or last week that makes you so angry. And you're going to process it through your spiritual time with God. But connect then is also about our family and our community, the community in our neighborhoods, the community here at worship and in this congregation, and the community that's around the church, and the community in which we live. How are you going to connect to those places and those times when you encounter other people? And growing is what we've been talking a lot about since the beginning of the year. You heard about the discipleship plan that your church is implementing, which is all about how is it that you grow as a Christian and grow into Christ-likeness. The daily office, the prayer practices, scripture studies, silence and solitude, having small groups. And then serve. How are you serving God in the larger world? What are you doing in service and mission? How are you reaching out and caring for other people? And then I've put generosity under here, because we serve by what we have to offer to the world. And we can either be stingy or we can be generous with what we have. And I'm not talking about just our finances, but that is certainly part of it. But it's also about, how do we give of ourselves, of our time and of our skills? How do we share what we have in order to help other people? You know, an example of that is what one of the stories that I've heard from Nebraska in the last couple weeks is the generosity of
of people who have donated their helicopters to lift hay to the cattle. You know, that's an act of living with generosity. But it can also include, are you tithing or are you working towards a tithe? Or where are you spending too much money that you can redirect then in other ways? How are you being generous? And then care for creation. Have you ever thought about serving God's creation? It's a blessing that we have and we need to care for it. What can you do to care for God's creation? Do you recycle? Great. But what's the next step you can do to reduce how much you have to recycle? For instance, no longer buying water in bottles so that you have fewer things to throw out. Making choices about how you use energy. What's the fuel efficiency of your car or the next vehicle that you buy? How are you going to heat and cool your house? How are you going to care for your lawn? Maybe you'd plant a butterfly garden so that you're caring for those species that, of God's creation. But care for creation is a way that we serve God. And then rest. It shouldn't be so hard for us to rest, but it is, isn't it? Taking time for Sabbath, living life with simplicity. That can mean things like getting rid of all but one of your credit cards. It can be making decisions, helping your children make decisions about what they want to be involved in so that they are not constantly running to after-school activities. Simplicity might be getting rid of stuff in your house so that you have less stuff to have to care for. How can you live more simply? And then play and recreation. I should have had Austin put that as play and recreation, because that's really what this rest is about. Is about how do we recreate ourselves in connection with God. So, rule of life. It's a choice you can make about how you live, how you treat other people, how you care for your coworkers, your bosses, those you supervise, the people, the clerks in the store, all of that, every moment of your day, you have the opportunity to give that to God as part of the way that you live. And in doing so, others will begin to see Christ in you. The rule of life, the pattern of living, frees us up so that we may become the unique people that God has created us to be. So that the love of Christ comes before everything else. So that first priority in our lives is living out the love of Christ. So may you let the love of God invade you. May we all be empowered by the love of God, that it may transform us into something new, into something that behaves differently in the world. Amen. As we transition into a time of getting our hearts and our souls ready for communion today, I'd just like to remind you that as you come forward to receive communion, you can drop your offering and your connection card into the basket that is up here. And we serve by intinction, which means you will receive a piece of bread that you then dip into the cup and consume both elements together. We also invite you to kneel at the communion rail if you would like to for a time of your own centering on God and this act and this blessing and gift that we have received. So we gather as God's people and celebrating with thanksgiving what God has given to us, which is the unconditional love that no matter who we are, no matter what we've done, no matter what we have, no matter what other people think about us, we can come before God in humility. God is always with us and offers us every day a new opportunity to fall in love with Him all over. And so we gather here to remember these gifts and the sacrifice that has been made for us so that we may know and experience that love. Christ sat at the table with his closest friends right before his death, and he shared with them all that he had remaining that he could pour out on them to let them know how much he loved them and how much God loved them and that they would never be abandoned. And he left us with the memory of the bread, the grain of the field, and the simple juice from the fruit of the vine as reminders that every time we gather in community at this table, we receive again Christ in us so that we may be transformed even more into the likeness and image of Christ so that we can serve others through all that we do until the time that we are able to be as one in Christ's heavenly kingdom. So the table is ready. Will you come? Invite the servers to come first. To announce the gluten-free option.
I surrender my life, I'm in awe of you.
Let us pray. Holy God, you have given us this great mystery by which your Son's body, crucified on the cross, has been made into bread and wine, that we may remember that he has sacrificed all for us, and that it may become who we are because of his sacrifice. Amen.
Amen. Would you please stand? Christ working through you, Christ in all that you do and all that you say and all that you are, so that others that you encounter may want to know the Christ that lives in you. Amen.